मीनिंग ऑफ चरण विधि। देन इट सेज हूँ अविनाशी छू, आई एम परमानेंट। विनाशी और टेम्पररी एंड अविनाशी और परमानेंट। सिचुएशंस और अवस्थाओं आर टेम्पररी एंड द सेल्फ इज परमानेंट। The one who knows that temporary situations are temporary is permanent. We have to understand that all these objects to be known and seen, or gneyo and drashyo, are temporary. And I, the knower and seer, am permanent. You are to understand that you are permanent. Then, avyayichu, I do not wear away. Vyay means to keep wearing away, to the point of nothingness. For example, someone will say the power in the batteries has been drained. They hadn't been used, but the device had been left on the entire night, and by morning the power was drained. Whereas no matter how much the self sees and knows, it never loses its purity. It has been around since time immemorial, but it does not wear away. Of its entire dravya or matter, it has not been worn away even in the slightest. This body will wear away. It exists on the basis of extra intent or vishesh bhav. Parmanu also do not wear away by nature. Parmanu do not perish. They are imperishable. But this non-self complex or pudgal that has arisen, this body, mind, speech, all of those relationships are temporary. They will wear away. No matter how much money one earns, the money will be consumed. These relationships wear away. The body will wear away, won't it? The moment one is born, influx or purana begins. And when the outflux or galan has finished, there will be death. That is when it gets finished off. It will have worn away.
Are parmanu of inanimate matter also avyay?
What is parmanu? It is the indivisible fraction of an atom. The atom or anu is a group or skand of many parmanu. When one parmanu comes together with another parmanu, it is called a skand or a collection. When there are two parmanus, three parmanus, that is referred to as a skand. And if it is a single parmanu, then it is called a parmanu. Parmanu itself is avinashi or permanent. It is avyay or does not wear away. Even parmanu of inanimate matter, it is an eternal element. Inanimate matter itself is in the form of parmanu. It is eternal. But there are infinite parmanu in the universe, and their relationship is such that they can come together. One atma or the self does not join together with one another. But parmanus come together and then a thing gets created. There are infinite parmanus in this body. The eyes are made of infinite parmanus, and so is each and every blood vessel. Everything is infinite parmanus. In just one bite, in just one grain of rice, there are infinite parmanus, but those parmanus manifest into something with form, something beautiful, or something unattractive. Then it has odor, whether it is fragrant or foul-smelling. Then it has taste. All the functional properties or guna-dharma exist in one parmanu. Which functional properties? Sour, salty, spicy, sweet, astringent, and bitter. Each parmanu has these functional properties. Then they have fragrance, foul smell, shape, and then touch. That is its functional property. The property of touch, so hot, cold, smooth, rough, sticky, dry, heavy, light, those are all functional properties. All of those functional properties exist in one parmanu, but they cannot be discerned in a parmanu. So then, what happens? When all the parmanu come together, that is when we know, oh, this piece of wood is light. Iron is heavy. This feels cold. This feels hot. All these properties of weight, heaviness, and so on are properties in the skand or collection of parmanu. The collection of parmanu is called vibhavik pudgal or pudgal that has deviated from its inherent nature. And vibhavik pudgal is temporary and the original parmanu is not temporary. Did you understand? I do not wear away. Hun sukshma chu. I am subtle. What is sukshma or subtle? Actually, beyond the sukshma or subtle, there is sukshmatam, or the subtlest. But it is subtle with respect to the sthul or gross. The self is so subtle that fire cannot burn it. Just imagine, what is fire? Fire is made up of Tejukai Jivo, or fire embodied organisms. There is space between these organisms. The self is able to pass through these spaces. Fire cannot burn it. Just imagine. That is how subtle the self is. It can pass through mountains. It can pass through fire. It remains unaffected even when the body is hanged. The noose cannot touch it. If the noose touches anything, it touches inanimate matter or jad. When the body is burnt, it is the inanimate matter that burns, not the self. The self is such that it cannot get burnt. I am subtle. All that is experienced through the senses is gross or sthool and has a form, roop, whereas I am subtle or sukshma and formless or arupi. Hum keval nirvikalp vitra gnan matrashu. I am nothing but the absolute form of knowledge, which is free from relative I-ness and minus, and free from attachment and abhorrence. Now, knowledge can be vikalpi, imaginary, or nirvikalpi, not imaginary. I am Baldev Bhai, I am her husband. That is all considered vikalp. How are you a husband? Hey, it is because I got married. Based on this, he will find all the knowledge to prove in what way he is considered a husband, in what way he is a father to his children, in what way that man is his father-in-law and he is a son-in-law. All that knowledge is vikalpi, imaginary, or knowledge with the belief that I am Chandubai, and all the relative I-ness that stems from it. And the self is a nirvikalpi, not imaginary, or is free from the belief that I am Chandubai, and all relative I-ness and minus that stems from it. Vikalpi Gnan makes one have attachment and abhorrence, whereas I am indeed nothing but the form of knowledge, which is nirvikalpi, not imaginary, free from relative I-ness and minus, and vitrag, free from attachment and abhorrence. Nirvikalpi means I am pure soul, I am full of infinite knowledge. That is considered having become nirvikalp. And it says, I am indeed nothing but the absolute form of knowledge, which is free from the relative I-ness and minus, and free from attachment and abhorrence. Then it says, Hu nirmal akut paramanand swarupichu. I am the embodiment of pure, endless, absolute bliss. Nirmal means pure or shuddh. Nirmal means without any contamination, without impurity. Impurities are created through attachment and abhorrence. Whereas if vitragta or the state of absolute detachment remains, then that is considered pure. So then it says nirmal akut. Akut means it does not run out. Paramanand means the embodiment of bliss. I am the embodiment of absolute bliss. Then it says, Hum sarva pardravyothi sarvatha udasi najchu. I am completely detached in every way from all other eternal elements. What is a dravya? There are six eternal elements in this world. One is chetan dravya or chetan tattva, the eternal element that knows and sees. The second element is that of jad or inanimate matter that is in the form of paramanu. Then akash or space is the third element. Then kal or time is the fourth element. Then there is gati sahayak, or the element of motion, and sthiti sayak, or the element of inertia. Of these six elements, we, the self, are chetan tattva. And what is our inherent nature like? Actually, none of the elements have anything to do with any of the others. That is how detached or udaseen we are. We are completely detached in every way from all other eternal elements, such as our original nature. So how did all this happen? Vishesh bhav, or extra intent, that I am Chandubai arose. Due to this extra intent, attachment, abhorrence occurs. Yet, the nature of the self is vitrag, or completely free of attachment and abhorrence. So truly, I am completely free of attachment and abhorrence in every way from all other eternal elements or pardravyo. Whenever I come into my own nature as the self, I am completely udaseen or detached from them. Udaseen means to not have anything to do with each other. It is because the vishesh bhav or extra intent has arisen that all six eternal elements became involved in it. One element provides space, another provides the goods, it becomes like a partnership of six. The original elements never become tainted, but they become tainted in the avastha, or circumstances, situations. They become tainted in their vibhavik, or unnatural state. The element of inanimate matter provides the goods. The element of space gives it space. The management is carried out by the element of time. Transport is carried out by the element of motion. Disposal is handled by the element of inertia. And the element of the self, or Chetan Tattva, is the supervisor. So this visor became a little overwise, the poor thing. He did not become a supervisor, but became overwise. It is indeed I. This is my place. All the baggage is mine. I earned the money. I incurred a loss. I am very cautious. So the I became the doer of everything. So then the other five are jabbing him. How is it that you have become the owner? You are the sixth partner. You only own 1/6 of the share. But he became the whole and sole doer. So when we get the knowledge of I am the pure soul, the mind, speech and body complex is an association of all the other five. We have become separate from them. That is not mine. Eventually, each element too will pull away. Now you, the self, became separate from them. Before you, the relative self, were the one who did the binding. You gathered all five and bound them. And that is why they were jabbing you. Now that you have moved away, all five have become released. So why did worries arise? It is because you believed I am Chandubhai that worries arose. The worries were due to the ego. Through the ego, you became the doer or karta. Therefore, you had to become the sufferer or bhokta. So now everyone has come into their inherent nature. As long as they were in vibhav or the belief of I am Chandubhai, there was entrapment. Now that I have come into my inherent nature or swabhav, by nature I am completely free of attachment and abhorrence in every way from all other eternal elements. I am detached. Dravya at its root means Dada uses a beautiful word vastu, element. An element has substance or dravya. It has intrinsic functional properties or gunadharma, and it has phases or avastha. That dravya is called an element or tattva. But what is tattva? In the scriptures, they have mentioned 9 other elements. Element is called something like an extract of matter. The essence is considered the element. So we call it a vastu. Dada gave us a nice clean word, vastu. There are 6 eternal elements or avinashi vastu. The element has matter, its mass and volume. Then it has its gunadharma or properties, and it has phases meaning paryay. Did you understand? Yet there is also something called 9 elements which causes confusion. Ajiv, jeev or non-living being, living being, pap punya or merit demerit karma, bandh moksha or bondage and liberation, nirjara samvar and ashra, that is discharge karma, stoppage of new discharge karma, and influx of karmic matter. All of these are considered the 9 elements. Did you understand? So although we can refer to it as tattva, we will use the word vastu for it. It is better to clarify it and use a clean, clear word so there is no confusion. So there are 6 eternal elements, and each element has its matter, intrinsic functional properties, and phases. Did you understand? Then it goes on to say, Surya saman tejasvi ane chandra saman shitaleva he vitragi paramatma. O absolute self that is completely free of all attachments, you are as illuminating as the sun and as serene as the moon. What is the real form or swarup of the Gnani like? He has the quality of being radiant like the sun as well as serene like the moon. It is not possible for anyone else to have both of these qualities at the same time. Yet such a state has arisen within the Gnani, and it is to such a one in the state of complete detachment that we bow down to, saying, O Absolute Self. Then it says, Tamam lepayman bhavuti hun sarvatha nirlepevo shuddhatma chu. I am the pure soul that remains forever unanointed from all the intents that tend to anoint. This is a very powerful sentence. It says, the intents that tend to anoint are intents of inanimate matter. They are not intents of the self. The self or Chetan is only the knower and seer of them. It is immiscible. It is in the form of absolute knowledge, Keval Gnan Swarup. What is referred to as Lepayman Bhav or intents that tend to anoint? When you see a mango, it is visible, but the intent arises that, I will eat it, I will enjoy it. The act of eating is considered an associated activity or sangi kriya. And then when one says, I really enjoyed it a lot, let's order one or two more baskets. Those are lepaiman bhavo, or intents that tend to anoint. These intents that tend to anoint arise on their own. Here, it is saying that the self remains unanointed or nirlep by them. These intents that tend to anoint belong to inanimate matter, and they arise on their own. When one sees a sari, she will say, I want to buy it. It will look good on me. That intent that tends to anoint arises, yet the self remains unanointed from it. This is a very subtle point. If you interact with anyone and he insults you, then the intents that tend to anoint arise within. The fool is unworthy. He's like this and like that. I'm going to get even with him. A storm is created through those intents that tend to anoint. And if you become one with them, it will create a big storm within. You have to remain unanointed from them, saying, why don't thousands of you arise? You are temporary and you are intents of the non-self, whereas I am eternal and my intrinsic nature is that of the soul. So there's inanimate matter or jad and the self or chetan, and the intents of inanimate matter or jad bhavo, and the intents of the self or chetan bhavo. People keep trying to separate the self and inanimate matter, but we actually have to go beyond that. So what is beyond the non-self and the self? That which comes and goes are intents of inanimate matter, and those of the knower who is eternal are intents of the self. So, to make this subtle demarcation is indeed referred to as the undeniable principle that accomplishes the ultimate goal or siddhant. This is the very principle that the Tirthankar Lord, the Lord who is the knower of all six eternal elements, has given. To observe intents of inanimate matter and of the self as separate. And the Lord himself remained in the intent of the self and remained unanointed and free from association with intents of the non-self. That is why he became free of attachment and attained liberation. So people claim everything is simply inanimate matter. But hey, within that inanimate matter are other intents of inanimate matter. One says, I am eating. To say I am eating or to believe I ate is itself the intent of inanimate matter. The doer and the sufferer, those are all intents of inanimate matter. The ego itself is intent of inanimate matter. These intents of inanimate matter arise on their own. They arise subject to another entity, or paradhin. They are under the authority of another entity, or parsatta. We do not give rise to them. They arise on their own.
Pujyashri, is that which charge is called jadbhav, or intents of inanimate matter?
No. Charging happens after becoming one with those intents of inanimate matter. The intents of inanimate matter were actually in the form of discharge. But in that one claims, it is definitely happening to me. Who else is there? It is only me. So then it becomes charged. So charging happens due to ignorance. The intents of inanimate matter are not such that they can become charged on their own. It is because of ignorance that one becomes engrossed. And by becoming engrossed, one charges for the next life. Did you understand? So it says, tamam lepaiman bhavuthi sarvatha. So, from all intents that tend to anoint, meaning throughout all of time, I am indeed unanointed. Another way to understand unanointed is in reference to the headlights of a car. They are very powerful. We turn them on as the evening sets in. Otherwise, the car does not need them. But when the evening sets in, it starts to become dark. So we turn on the lights. Then the lights will pass over mud, fall on the hills, fall on the walls, fall on the stones, the light falls on animals. But does the light become soiled? If it passes over mud, will it become smelly? If it passes over stones, will it get into an accident? So the light does not clash with anything, does not get soiled, does not smell, it does not hurt anyone. The intrinsic nature of light is to remain unanointed. It can pass by everything. It touches everything as it passes by. But even if it were to pass through a sewer, it would not smell. Even if it passes through a garden of flowers, it will not become fragrant. If one says, I smell a strong fragrance, then that is the ego, the intents that tend to anoint. Whereas we, the self, Atma, are unanointed. Despite seeing and knowing things with a fragrance or things with a bad odor, the self remains unanointed. Despite seeing and knowing bad things, beautiful things or ugly things, the self remains unanointed. So who becomes anointed? It is the intent of the non-self complex, the ego. One will say, I got really nervous. The moment I saw her, I became lost in attraction. The one that got lost is separate, and that too is actually the effect of discharge. Once you understand that, he's the one who became infatuated, not me. I am the knower of how infatuated he became. Then you are considered separate. You are unanointed from that. That is why it is said that the intents that tend to anoint are such that they cannot anoint the self. So this is where your purusharth or real spiritual effort is needed. Regardless of whichever intent that tends to anoint arises, just say this one sentence aloud. From all intents that tend to anoint, I remain forever unanointed as the pure soul. But you need to recognize these intents that tend to anoint. This happened to me. That happened to me. I had throbbing pain. I tried very hard to keep it separate. It is happening to Deepak, but even then, I had suffering. Even the one that says I was suffering is not you. It is the Vedak, or the one who feels the pain, that says I am in a lot of pain. The one who feels the pain is the ego, and we are unanointed from that as well. These are very subtle points. It is saying, from all intents that tend to anoint, I remain forever unanointed as the pure soul. Then it says, Man vachan kayani tamam sangi kriyauti hun taddan asangajchu. I am completely free of association from the associated actions of the mind, speech and body. This is a very profound statement. What does it mean? Dada says, we even give this gnan to married couples. We have not asked one to become an ascetic. So then, how can the awareness as the self prevail? It is because the self is free of association from every sanghi kriya. What is sanghi kriya? For example, if you touch me, anything that touches the body is called sanghi kriya or associated action. Therefore, in associated actions, the self is indeed free of association. Just imagine, it has never become soiled. That is why this gnan has even been given to married couples. No matter how much sexuality exists, but if one remains in gnan such that I am free of association from every associated action, then you should not allow any doubts to arise such as, have I become spoiled? No, you can never become spoiled. Such is our real form. It says that I am free of association from every associated action. One may ask, how do associated actions take place through the mind? To keep recalling in the mind, to keep remembering through the mind, means one has become associated with the mind. If you say Baldev Bhai, then that means there has been an association with speech. And if someone touched you through the body, then you become associated through the body. In the mind, speech and body's associated actions, does one not say, I felt very cold? Yet that is an associated action. The one who says, it happened to me, that is also an associated action. And in that associated action, the self is free from association.
So Deepak Bhai, does that mean that there is a difference between the nature of being immiscible or tankotkirna and being free of association or asangi?
The difference is that as long as we have not attained the full experience, we are trying to fit it into our understanding in various ways. Once we attain the full experience, then everything is together. Self is one with all its intrinsic properties. That is called a property or guna. Guna means that as long as it comes into experience in different ways, that is referred to as guna. Whereas when everything becomes complete and one becomes established with all the intrinsic properties, then it is considered the full manifestation of all the properties of the self. What is a guna or property? For example, ananta gnan or infinite knowledge. If one is knowing the gneo or objects to be known, then he becomes the knower. When one is seeing the drashyo or the objects to be seen, then one is considered the seer. When suffering arises, one says, Hum avya bhad svarupchu, or I can never be hurt nor can I hurt anyone. When they have to be used individually, they are called properties. Did you understand?
Pujya Shri, then can we say that the extra intent or vishesh bhav that has arisen has done so in the pudgal or non-self complex and not in the self?
It arises in the pudgal. But what do we call the pudgal? Parmanu, or the smallest, most indivisible and indestructible particle of matter, is not considered pudgal. Beliefs are considered pudgal. So clearly understand the fact that all this has arisen due to the presence of both. The element of inanimate matter alone cannot give rise to the pudgal. Nor can the element of self alone give rise to the pudgal. The Vishesh Gunadharma or additional functional property arises because both have come into close proximity with one another. And in that, extra intent has arisen in the non-self complex or pudgal, in the element of inanimate matter, as well as in the element of the self. However, the nature of the element of the self itself has not become spoilt. This Vishesh Bhav or additional extra intent has arisen. In Vishesh Bhav, extra intent, if the self says that the Vishesh Bhav or extra intent is mine alone, then that is not acceptable. And if the non-self says that the Vishesh Bhav or extra intent is mine alone, then that too is not acceptable. It has arisen because of the two coming together. Thereafter, both the element of inanimate matter and the element of the self become distorted. Not the original self, but the knowledge belonging to the self acquires extra knowledge. Otherwise, the self's original knowledge has not been spoiled, but it is extra knowledge. Just as gold possesses the property that allows it to be bent. To bend is a property of gold. That property of malleability allows it to turn into a bangle. It is a phase that has arisen. Did you understand? But that does not mean that its original property has become spoiled. It is bent into shape due to outside pressure. That property still remains as it is, but due to other circumstances. What do we call that? We can say that the extra property of malleability has arisen. When another elemental force came upon it, when it was hit with a hammer, it became bent. So it bends due to pressure from something else. So it can only bend when there is another element. Otherwise, it cannot keep bending on its own. But this property exists within it. So the property which arose due to the other element is called an extra property. And because of the extra property, a bangle was created. But if the bangle were to say, I am a bangle, then you would respond, no, you are gold. But due to an extra attribute, you are a bangle.
What I am asking is, the self resides within the body. Suppose it is in the leg. And if the leg is straight, the self is straight. When the leg is bent, the self bends too, doesn't it?
We may say that it got bent, but the self does not bend. At the most, the ego gets bent. One says, I bent a lot. I bent, so my legs bent. But the self does not bend. What is it like here? Suppose you have a pot of water or else a bottle. If we cork the bottle and turned it upside down, then can we say that the water turned upside down? The bottle turned upside down. But how can water be turned upside down? Or if you put a pot over a light bulb and turn it upside down, does the light turn upside down? So this upside down and right side up is really language of illusion. The one that knows that it became bent is not bent himself. The knower is never bent. He knows how much got bent. The knower remains separate and continues to know that this became bent. Therefore, the self or pote never becomes bent. And whether it is straightforwardness or waywardness, it is all of the ego. It is all happening to the body and not the self. Hey, we have been seated in the state of absolute knowledge. You are listening, you are seeing, you are knowing. Our samayik is indeed being carried out. But when there are only discussions about the element of the self or atma tattva, there is indeed natural and spontaneous introspective analysis of the self or samayik. We indeed become that form. By continuously listening, we are becoming that form. The self is completely free of association from associated actions. Then comes Man vachan kayani tevo ane tena svabhav ne hu janu chu ane mara sva svabhav ne pan hu janu chu. I know the habits of the mind, speech and body and the intrinsic nature of those habits, and I also know my intrinsic nature as the self. Here the key words are habits or tevo and the intrinsic nature of habits or tevo no svabhav. What is meant by a habit or tev? When sitting down to have a meal, the people of Kathiawad or Western Gujarat will place a lot of insistence on their guests to eat more, whereas people of Surat or Southern Gujarat are not inclined upon insisting. They will say, eat if you like, everything has been placed here. So what is that called? It is a habit. And the intrinsic nature of a habit means that if there is a lot of insistence, then it is considered heavier in nature, and if there is less insistence, then it is considered lighter in nature. Intrinsic nature means layers. If it is sticky, then we can say that the nature is heavy. If it is mild, then the nature is light. But whose nature is it? It is of the habits. Some people are hasty and some are impatient. Those are habits. And then habits increase and decrease in intensity. So that is what it means. Don't many people have a habit of drinking alcohol? That is a habit of alcohol. But the one who says, I drink once a month, the nature of that habit is light. Whereas for the one who drinks three times a day, the nature of that habit is heavy. It is called a habit of drinking. There are habits of the body, habits of the speech, and there are also habits of the mind. So, I know the habits of the mind, speech, and body, and the intrinsic nature of those habits. And I also know my intrinsic nature as the self. All of these habits are of the mind, speech, and body. They are not mine because I am Swapar Prakashak, or that which illuminates the non-self and the self. I can know all that is in the non-self, and I can also know my own self. Now, we are to see the habits and the nature of the habits as separate. It is the nature of the Pudgal. It is the nature of the habits. It is not my nature. As you see that, the layers will decrease one after another. Do you understand? Don't people say, the father has a very angry nature? His son is a bit less angry, but the father is very angry. So the nature of this person is heavy, and his is light. Those are all natures. Of what? Of habits. And we have to know those habits and know the nature of those habits. And we also have to know our intrinsic nature as well. We are trying to make this separation.